Hi, everybody. Welcome to Video Gold. Today, we're going to see how soap operas can be used to preach the gospel, the inner workings of a worldwide ministry, and visit a very funky factory. But first, we're going to give you a little glimpse of a typical concert day. So from the album, Addicted to Jesus, we're giving you an open invitation. Come into this house.
I know this is going to come as a shock to you.
To this house. I like the fellowship and the koinonia that you get from being in the church. You know, I really feel that we are the church, and when we go to the physical building, we go to edify one another, to build each other up.
As a believer, to stay strong, you've got to be around other people that believe the same as you do and encourage you and uphold you.
It's not a religious thing, you know, to come every Sunday, but to me it's, you know, coming to almost, you know, get food.
It's fun to come to church, and you can have a relationship with Jesus and church be something that's enjoyable and not a duty or a responsibility.
You've got to be a church, you know. If you're not, you know, you can't get any kind of spiritual input in your life.
You need a shepherd to lead you where you want to go, where you're going actually. And the pastor is a shepherd for us.
You know, a lot of times it's hard to invite people to church and like your neighbors and stuff. But if we just are bold, like the Bible says, just be bold as a lamb. Just ask people, say, hey, you want to come to church with me? You know, that's a part that I think everybody can play.
Down through the years, it's been an honor and a privilege to bring the gospel to you through these concert crusades we've held. Now, the reason we call the concerts crusades is because it's not only one or the other, but it's a combination of both. We take the methods used in a concert and try to get the results of an evangelistic crusade. We kind of like put it in a blender and add some lights and some staging and some dancers and confetti, and voila, it's a concert crusade. Another element that gives it that crusade feel is the fact that in almost every city we have one of these crusades, and I don't charge an admission price. The reason is definitely not financial. You haven't lived until you've tried to take up an offering from teenagers. Many times our budget can be as high as $100,000 a night. When we're in a stadium, it's more like $300,000 a night. Most people don't know that for us, seeing that a good 60 to 70% of our audience is young people, we rarely make budget with the offering. We have to pull it in from many other sources just to make ends meet. But the results are worth it. Studies tell us that by the time a young person passes the age of 18, there is only a 15% chance that they'll find Christ the Savior. 85% of all conversions happen under the age of 18. So I've learned many years ago that the greatest investment you'll ever make with your time, your money, or your talent is when you invest in the souls of men. From the Raising the Standard live video, here's the opening clip that gives you a brief overview of what the heart of Carmen Ministries is all about. Jesus says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. And for 18 years, I've held fast to that scripture. To reach out to people of all ages, color barriers, no matter what their social background is, I wanted to make it so that anybody who wanted to could come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. To unite the generations and the denominations. That's exactly what the Lord put in my spirit so many years ago. But in order to put that together, it took a crew of 33 men working literally all day long just to make sure that it was perfect for everybody when they walked through the doors. We tried so hard to please them. And when it was all said and done, we knew that they were ministered to. These guys left the normalcies of their lives, their families, wives, kids, because Jesus says, if you love me, feed my sheep. And each one of these guys loved the Lord. Just to give you an idea of some of the things we've been involved in, we wanted to do an outreach to the city of Detroit. We knew of some of the problems they were having in the inner city, gangs, violence. So we went to the Pontiac Silver Dome, Pontiac, Michigan, which is just outside of Detroit. We did a concert free of charge, threw open the door so that anybody who wanted to could come, and over 30,000 young people filled that place to hear Jesus Christ as Lord. But it didn't stop there for us. We wanted to be a witness wherever a witness was needed. And to me, that was at spring break in Daytona Beach, Florida. I don't know if you realize this, but spring break is a parent's worst nightmare. Nearly 400 colleges and high schools empty out across the United States. And they go down to Daytona Beach, and for a few weeks, it's nothing but sex, drugs, rock and roll, AIDS, suicide.
rape, you name it, it happens. We set up right on the beach, right between Playboy and MTV, and we preach Jesus to them all night long. Thousands of lives were changed. One of the most violent places in our country is called Fort Apache in the Bronx, appropriately named because of the high crime rate. The police department was worried that the gangs would begin to formulate, so they sent out 200 police officers on foot and on horseback to surround the park in case any problems broke out. Well, there was not one incident reported. As a matter of fact, we had time left over to lead many of the police officers to the Lord that day. The first ever gospel concert of its kind in Barbados. They never had anything like this happen in their country. But they says, pray that it doesn't rain. They're very superstitious. If it rains, they won't come. It did nothing but rain. However, they came with their umbrellas down to the altar to receive Jesus Christ as Lord. Wanderers Cricket Stadium, Johannesburg, South Africa. God had put it in my spirit 18 years before to see stadiums filled with people worshiping the Lord. We actually had to go outside of our country to see this happen for the very first time. I went to that stadium when I was on tour in Africa and walked the perimeters of it, claiming it for the glory of God. It was 1 year later that 50,000 people came to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ set to music. That stadium had never been used for any musical purposes prior to that. Even Nelson Mandela came to that event. But nothing compared to seeing this kind of response to the gospel happen in my home country, the United States of America. God put it in my spirit to do a concert crusade at, of all places, Texas Stadium. The thought of that larger-than-life venue filled with people of all ages worshiping the Lord was just intoxicating. But after 12 months of planning, 4,000 volunteers, and innumerable hours of prayer, on October 22, 1994, 71,132 people filled the enormous and legendary Texas Stadium, making it the largest Christian concert ever. People of all ages will come and worship the Lord at these concerts. Folks that have never felt the presence of God in their lives will come, and many for the very first time worship the Lord openly and unashamedly. For nearly two decades, I've never compromised the gospel of Jesus Christ, never taken Jesus out, and I never will.
Of the young and the restless, it's not that they're young, they're just restless.
I've always been one to be very devoted to my church. I believe that the true strength and durability of any minister will ultimately rest on whether or not they're part of a local church body. You see, even though someone may be a very popular Christian singer, musician, or even an evangelist, it doesn't make them exempt from their need to be pastored. You see, a pastor hears from God concerning the needs of the flock. He then breaks it down and delivers to us the spiritual food we need to live productive Christian lives. Now, we as singers, musicians, evangelists, and even prophets and apostles take what we have learned at church and bring it out to the world. Now, many musicians have reversed the process and try to take what they've learned in the world and bring it into the church. It just doesn't work. Most of the songs I've written, at least the really effective ones, I got from listening to my pastor preach. Even if his sermon wasn't his best ever, God still honors the commitment and gives you something anyway. The song you're about to hear is something my pastor talked about in the midweek Bible study. He actually used the titles from popular soap operas to preach a message of salvation. I was so intrigued by the idea, I got the tape and listened to it over and over and over again until I figured out a way to put it into a song. I tried it one night at a concert and everybody went crazy. It became such a mainstay at the live concerts that I decided to put it on my Radically Saved record. So, recorded live at the Brady Theater in Tulsa, Oklahoma during the fall of 1987, here for your listening pleasure is a little song called Soap Song.
Gone are the days of Leave It to Beaver. Matt Dillon and his sidekick, Festus. Now we survive on the immoral lives of those of the young and the restless. It's not that they're young, they're just restless. Not living at all like they should. So they go to the general hospital. And the doctors can't do them no good. So they keep on with their search for tomorrow. Not doing one thing that's right. And they all end up in another world. About to fall off the edge of night. Well, that shouldn't matter, because after all, as the world turns, you only have but one life to live. There remains a blessed hope for you and all your children. More hope than Ryan could ever give. If we want true contentment, peace in our homes, with an end to marital strife, we must live for Jesus Christ, the only guiding light. Not one, but all the days of our lives.
The TV, the movies, everything is just, it deals with ungodly issues and it deals with them in ungodly ways. And that's the effect that it brings to us. And as a Christian, you're going to feel like you've been spiritually violated.
If you sit there and all day and you watch talk shows, you know, and you know, all the soap operas and things like that, that, you know, all the sin and the corruption that are in those, you know, whether you want to or not, they just get into your life.
We are losing our young people through, because of the TV.
It's a known fact that TV, it influences our world, whether it be fashion or phrases that people say. And the more we watch, the more that becomes us.
Your spirit's going to tell you when you shouldn't be hearing this, when you shouldn't be watching this. And you've got to follow those convictions, what the Holy Spirit is telling for you. But you've got to make that choice to be committed to that commitment, committed to that conviction.
TV is just a devil's playground, basically. I really do think that.
As believers, we have to be real careful because it's very powerful. I mean, we all know it's probably the most powerful thing right now that we fight against.
The Bible says in Romans 8:28 that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. In that one scripture, God revealed something about His heart, His nature, and His character. He desires to take the negative things of your life and, if you love Him, turn them into something positive. He takes a negative and He turns it into a positive. And He does it all day long. You know, I've taken the principle of Romans 8:28, a negative and turning it into a positive, and used it even in writing songs. Many years ago, 1987, I heard the word radical going around. Everything was radical. Everything, she's rad, he's rad, this is rad. The Lord told me to sanctify that word in the hearts and minds of believers. So we're around the country telling everybody, don't be radical, but do get radically saved. Then about 5 years after that, I was reading USA Today, and in it said 1 out of 100 Americans are addicted to cocaine. The Lord told me, tell them don't get addicted to drugs, but do get addicted to Jesus. And then a few years back, I was watching TV, and it seemed like, maybe you had noticed it too, everything that went wrong turns into a riot. I asked the Lord, is there any way I can take the word riot and use it in such a way as to inspire people to take a stand for their faith in Christ? The Holy Spirit then led me to the dictionary to find out the definition of the word. So I did, and when I opened it up, Webster's Dictionary said, a riot is like an unrestrained uproar in a public place. I said, bam, there it is. An unrestrained uproar in a public place. I mean, it sounds like the dictionary was describing one of our concert crusades. I knew then for sure we had the working title of a record. I just needed something a bit more meaningful from the word riot. So I thought to turn the letters of the word into something a bit more significant. So after weeks of my office staff and I racking our brains, we came up with R-I-O-T, riot, or righteous invasion of truth. Just like the Lord gives new meaning to our lives, He gave new meaning to the word.
I love the fact of invading the territory where Satan has, it looks like that he's just taken over the inner cities.
It's very important getting the gospel to the inner city because so many people neglect that.
The heart of any nation is the cities, and as we go into the heart of it, and that's where the blood pumps, and if it's purified through the heart, then it goes out and extends everywhere else.
If we can change the cities, what kind of change is that going to bring about in our nation?
In Acts 1 and 8 it says, you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth.
Go to your neighbor first. Someone that you haven't spoke to in your neighborhood, in your grocery store, that you see every day, that you at least have a visual contact with, and start telling them about the Lord.
We have to bring the truth of God, the only truth there is, to our world. If that means an invasion, we're certainly willing to do that.